Today we come to another one chapter letter of John called 3 John. There are actually 3 letters in the Bible written by John. The second and third of those letters are very short. In fact, the one we are looking at today has the official distinction of being the shortest entry in the entire Bible. Today our focus is on the third of John's 3 letters. Let me read it in its entirety, and then we'll walk through it a bit together. This letter is from John the Elder. I am writing to Gaius, my dear friend, whom I love in the truth. Dear friend, I hope all is well with you and that you are as healthy in body as you are strong in spirit. Some of the traveling teachers recently returned and made me very happy by telling me about your faithfulness and that you are living according to the truth. I could have no greater joy than to hear that my children are following the truth. Dear friend, you are being faithful to God when you care for the traveling teachers who pass through, even though they are strangers to you. They have told the church here of your loving friendship. Please continue providing for such teachers in a manner that pleases God, for they are traveling for the Lord, and they accept nothing from people who are not believers. So we ourselves should support them so that we can be their partners as they teach the truth. I wrote to the church about this, but Diotrephes, who loves to be the leader, refuses to have anything to do with us. When I come, I will report some of the things he is doing and the evil accusations he is making against us. Not only does he refuse to welcome the traveling teachers, but also tells others not to help them. And when they do help, he puts them out of the church. Dear friend, don't let this bad example influence you. Follow only what is good. Remember that those who do good prove that they are God's children, and those who do evil prove that they do not know God. Everyone speaks highly of Demetrius, as does the truth itself. We ourselves can say the same for him, and you know we speak the truth. I have much more to say to you, but I don't want to write it with pen and ink, for I hope to see you soon, and then we will talk face to face. Peace be with you. Your friends here send you their greetings. Please give my personal greetings to each of our friends there. Whether you're a Christian or you're just exploring things, if you're digging into the Bible at all, you need to read it fairly and rightly. And one of the most important principles, the first one I would tell anybody, is when you're reading Scripture, let Scripture interpret Scripture. For example, in this case, if John was saying something as significant and as provocative as the guarantee of health and wealth if you walk closely with Christ, that'd be kind of a big deal, and it would be a clear principle taught in Scripture. It isn't. So that should lead anyone reading this to be careful not to read too much into an opening greeting like this, particularly something as sweeping as the idea of health and wealth being tied to your relationship with Jesus. Now, God can certainly bring about material blessing. He can certainly bring healing. But it's also true that some of the greatest saints in the Bible faced all kinds of persecution and poverty and hardship and difficulty. So that ought to make you pause right there in reading more than a greeting into the opening lines of John. A second principle, besides letting Scripture interpret Scripture, is to make sure that you never take a verse out of context. And this is a good example. John is writing to address an internal issue within the church relating to a major personality conflict with Diotrephes. There's nothing in the letter about the problem of pain or evil or poverty or about how a walk with God brings wholeness or success or wealth. So to read that into the greeting would not be exegesis, which is discovering what the text itself says. It would be eisegesis, which is adding your own stuff to what the text says. The context is clear. This is a personal letter, opening with a common greeting of the day to segue into a particular issue that John was writing to Gaius about. Dear friend, you are being faithful to God when you care for the traveling teachers who pass through, even though they're strangers to you. They have told the church here of your loving friendship. Please continue providing for such teachers in a manner that pleases God, for they're traveling for the Lord, and they accept nothing from people who are not believers. So we ourselves should support them so that we can be their partners as they teach the truth. I love that section. John's very specific in his teaching and his praise. Gaius and others in the church are serving these traveling teachers, and they should have been. This was good and right and strategic and important for them to do, even if they were strangers, meaning their generosity wasn't tied to giving because they knew someone or were in on something or were a part of something. No, they gave out of duty. They gave out of responsibility, the needs of the cause. It wasn't about them. It was about the mission. And John makes 2 other things clear. He said, look, if Christians don't support Christian ministry, who is? I mean, if followers of Christ are not supporting, you know, what Christ's cause is, who is? And when Christians do support the mission, John says, and he reminds Gaius of this, he says, you're partnering with that mission. It's you're playing a part in the ministry. I mean, you're a traveling teacher. You're a traveling pastor. You're a traveling evangelist because of that. You know, we're working in an orphanage. We're housing the homeless. We're feeding the hungry. We're reaching people for Christ and baptizing them and seeing them grow. That's what it is when you give. You know, you become a partner in the actual act in God's eyes. Well, that was what John had to say to Gaius and about the importance of serving the needs of the church and its mission. But then John gets to the heart of what prompted this letter. I wrote to the church about this, he says, but Diotrephes, who loves to be the leader, refuses to have anything to do with us. When I come, I will report some of the things he's doing, the evil accusations he is making against us. Not only does he refuse to welcome the traveling teachers, but he also tells others not to help them. And when they do help, he puts them out of the church. Here John tells Gaius he's tried to write to the church about this, tried to write to Diotrephes about this. He's tried sending traveling teachers to the church, but Diotrephes has stood in the way. Even worse, those folks who have tried to do the right thing have been put out of the church by Diotrephes. We don't know all the details about this, but we are told here by John that this rogue leader liked to be the one in charge, the one controlling things, the one who's always first. So instead of welcoming traveling teachers, even one sent by the Apostle John as a leader of the Christian movement in that area and in authority over Diotrephes, he rejects them. He doesn't want anybody on his turf, anybody kind of threatening his position or his role. He sets himself up as being in complete charge and control. If anybody challenges that, kicks him out of the church. Diotrephes himself was probably so self-deceived, so cut off from Christ, that he probably wasn't even in touch with some of this stuff. And that's true of a lot of problem people. That I found that they can be incredibly self-deceived. They really kind of have rationalized their bad behavior. They give into a particular attitude like spiritual pride or greed or control, and then they have so given over themselves over to it that they rationalize it. And almost like, I'm being this way for Jesus' sake. So in their self-deception, they really can think they are the spiritual ones. Diotrephes may have thought John was the bad guy. And that's because he had quenched the work of the Holy Spirit in his life. He had ignored conviction. He had given into rebellion against authority. He'd given into pride. So while he might have been talking a spiritual line, that's not what is motivating him at all. As John said, this guy just likes to be in charge and in control and first. Which is why John reminds Gaius about how to read people like that. It's a pretty straightforward litmus test. He says, dear friend, don't let this bad example influence you. Follow only what is good. Remember that those who do good prove that they are God's children, and those who do evil prove that they don't know God. John's litmus test, judge them by their fruit. Don't ever say that evil is justified for, the ends justify the means. Don't ever say, well, we'll let evil because there's some good stuff going over here. No. If they do good, it's a reflection that they really are one of God's children. But if they do evil, it shows that they don't know him. And by doing good, it's not just about doing good things or being successful or having lots of results. It's not about numbers. On the surface, Diotrephes may have looked like the best Christian leader around, best speaker, whatever. But John was making it clear that it's what's beneath the surface, behind the numbers and the success, that matters. And there, Diotrephes was far from God. He was arrogant, prideful, egocentric, conniving, lying, deceiving, and slanderous. John had a different picture of true character, a different picture of leadership. As an apostle, he had spent 3 years with Jesus, including that last night before his death, in the room where he took a bowl and a towel and went from man to man, including John himself, and washed their feet and said, as I have served you, you serve others. So, shortest letter of the Bible, but it kind of covers a lot of ground, doesn't it? We talked about how to interpret the Bible fairly and on its own terms. We learned about the importance of being financial players in the church. 3 John also points us toward issues related to pride and arrogance and to judge people on the basis of character in terms of real fruit. So a lot in a little letter.